I am Dr. Lori, and I want to know, can you pick the most valuable? So when you're at the thrift store, the flea market, the yard sale, wherever you are, can you pick the most valuable? I'm going to talk about all different diverse objects and tell you the values, and so you can start to learn what's the most valuable, or continue to learn what's the most valuable. So this first piece is a cookie jar, and I'm going to tell you about cookie jars, and I want you to understand how to identify date when it comes to cookie jars, right? Now, a lot of you have known about cookie jars, and you've heard all the stuff about cookie jars. No, they can be very, very valuable. Well, there was a time when they were very, very expensive, in the thousands even. That's not so much what we see with cookie jars now, but this particular cookie jar is the little old lady who lived in a shoe. And if you look at cookie jars of the post-war period, so after 1945, the GIs come home for, like my father, we had a big cookie jar, and most of the cookie jars are in fact nursery rhymes. Makes sense, you know, it's kind of cutesy for the kitchen, and of course relates to that post-war American time when the GIs are coming home, they're getting married, the baby boom happens after World War II. Very typical. So this is the little old lady who lived in a shoe. We had the cookie jar, it was Humpty Dumpty, and it was a red cookie jar with the bricks, and then Humpty was up on, it was before he, you know, got broken and fell off and, you know, crashed himself and all this. Anyway, this our particular cookie jar was that on my mom's 1960s, 1970s, of course, countertop. But for kitchens in America, nursery rhymes were a big deal because they related to the baby boom. That's what this is. This cookie jar is okay. It's kind of cutesy, but you kind of have to figure it out. It's like, oh, there's a big shoe, and you know, you're looking at the big shoe, and it's ceramic, of course, and then there's just a little person kind of looking out. So the little old lady lived in a shoe. So many children didn't know what to do. That's what this cookie jar is. This particular cookie jar holds a lot of cookies. That's the other tip about cookie jars and how you can identify valuable ones and how old they are. Cookie jars in the early 1900s were small. They were called biscuit jars because the cookies were smaller and the people were smaller. As we went on after World War II in the middle part of the 1900s in America, the cookies got bigger and so did we, right? So everybody's getting a little fatter by after World War II, the age of prosperity. The cookie jars are bigger, and they usually relate to, of course, nursery rhymes. Value on this cookie jar, you might be surprised, it's worth about $250. So that's a valuable cookie jar. It's in very good condition, ceramic. So if you have chips or you have cracks, forget it. Next, now my mother's cookie jar, we wouldn't be allowed to do anything. You have to be very careful. You want a cookie out of there? Well, be careful because you're not going to chip or crack the cookie jar. She was extremely immaculate, very clean, and don't mess anything up. So it's a good thing I didn't have brothers because maybe they would have been harder on everything. This next piece is a JFK Memorial Record Album. John F. Kennedy assassinated in November, of course, of 1963. Many of his speeches and many of his remarks were put into books and also put into albums. And vinyl, very important. Vinyl, still very collectible. We didn't care about vinyl for a while, and then it made a resurgence. And this is important about the market. You want to think about market resurgence. What's going to come back in vogue? Things I've been telling you usually come back in vogue in 50 and 100 year cycles. When it comes to music, music usually has a much shorter time before it comes back. You can see in a decade or even only two decades for certain types of music to come back in vogue. So we saw the vinyl resurgence of record albums after, of course, having MP3 and digital files and cassettes and CDs and DVDs and all of this kind of stuff. So record albums have come back strong, and historical record albums are relatively rare. This one was made in large numbers because everybody wanted something JFK. Now, of course, I can't say, oh, I remember where I was when John F. Kennedy was assassinated because I wasn't born yet. But many people do remember, of course, where they were when Kennedy was assassinated. I remember my mother telling us where she was when Kennedy was assassinated. I remember, of course, many people having that conversation of where were you and who told you and how did you hear. Many people heard on television, which was a big deal because remember, Kennedy also had the first TV debate with Nixon. This piece, this record album, is worth $40. Original sleeve is very important. So anytime you're looking at the original sleeve, you're looking at the original piece, you want to make sure that you have a good condition for the record album. If it's all scratched up, that's not so great either. When you're looking for objects and you want to know what's most valuable, I talk a lot about jewelry. And I talk a lot about costume jewelry, and I talk a lot about fine jewelry and knowing the difference. So this is a set. This is a set made by a company named Matisse in enamel, and it's a palette. So it's an artist palette in green enamel with a couple of other colors, and then it's matching earrings with the palette and the paint brushes. It's really a nice example of the 1960s, and it's clearly marked. Now, people will say, oh, you know, it's not marked, it's not valuable, and that's not always true with costume jewelry. A lot of nice costume jewelry is unmarked. Some of the marks, of course, are, of course, listed on our website. If you go to the research and you look at costume jewelry, you can see many of the different makers that have marks. And I want you to understand that this is a Matisse piece. Now, Matisse, there was a company named Matisse, and then another costume jewelry company named Renoir, too. So the Matisse company made these pieces that related to that idea, of course, of fine art. This is a nice piece, and it's nice for a couple of reasons. It's nice because the enamel is still intact in very good condition. It's nice because it's colorful and it's the set. Always keep the sets intact. Always keep the sets intact. Because if you don't keep the set intact, if you have the set and you start breaking it up, you lose value by a lot. So keep the sets intact. This particular set worth $125 costume jewelry. Now, a lot of you are going to have said to me, oh, you know, I can get it cheaper, I can get it this, I can get it that. Make sure you're getting some of the better names when it comes to costume jewelry. And you may have to pay more for those better names. The Weisses, the Hattie Carnegie, the Marivella, a lot of them. So sometimes the Napier, sometimes the Monet, those kinds of things. So remember, those are very, very important. Weiss and Matisse and Renoir and others. 1960s, worth $125. Then there's salt and pepper shakers. Now a lot of you are going, oh, the salt and pepper shaker market. My aunt, you know, I have one client who always says, my aunt, she collected all these salt and pepper shakers. My family would go over there to visit, and I would have to play with the salt and pepper shakers because there was nothing else to do because it's boring. I had a lot of aunts. My mother was one of nine, and we were always involved with, we used to call them the aunts, right? And they're lovely people, and they loved us a lot, but they were always, you know, they lived down the street, they lived down the block, they lived close by. You know, it was like the Italian clan thing, and it was great. You know, I was close to my cousins and close to my aunts and all of this, but there were a lot of them. So when you had to go visiting, it would get boring. So you'd start to sort of try to find things in their houses that would be kind of fun. So like at my Aunt Dorothy's house, my Aunt Dorothy had a doll that was named for my cousin, and that doll we used to play with. So when we went to Aunt Dorothy's, we had something to play with. Or when we went to my Aunt Chris's, she would always make tea. So we would sit around and have tea, and I would oftentimes play with the accessories because she was a big smoker. So she would have a lot of tobacco accessories around, you know, tobacco jars and cool little ashtrays and stuff like that. So I'd play with those. So, you know, it's like anything else when you have to go to a relative's house when you're a little kid, you kind of have to, you know, kind of get along and do stuff. So these particular salt and pepper shakers remind me of those visits to my aunt's houses. So the salt and pepper shakers here are glass. They are depression glass salt and pepper shakers. So you'll notice a couple things about it. You'll notice that it has that nice concentric circular design, which is very, very typical of the geometric designs of course, the Art Deco period from the 1920s into the 1930s. Notice the color, green and pink, most popular depression glass colors. There are other colors that are popular too, but these two tend to be the most popular colors when we see on the marketplace for depression glass. Remember, some depression glass is made well after the depression era into the 1950s, but these are made in the 1930s, and they have, of course, the metal tops, and you know that you have the salt with the pepper, and they're always together. If they get separated, oh, God love you, they got separated. Now we got a big problem because you can't find the salt or the pepper. So they're always kept together. And I remember my aunt, maybe you guys had these too, but one of my aunts actually had a little picnic table, and they sat right on the picnic table, this little miniature picnic table on the countertop, and the salt and pepper shakers were always there, and they were always, you had to put them back there too so you didn't lose them. Value on this set, Art Deco, $65. Can you pick the most valuable? This is a piece that I hope you're going to be able to recognize. This particular piece is our nation's capital, and it's a map of our nation's capital. This particular map is quite old, as you can tell from the paper. So when you're looking at maps, I want you to look at particular aspects of a map. This particular map is one that dates to 1793. So it's a quite old map, and it's based on, of course, the city plan of L'Enfant, you know, L'Enfant Plaza, of course, Washington, D.C., and where you're going to have, again, those particular avenues and streets going different ways. You can see the plan, and you can also see a couple of things that I want you to understand about it. Notice the indentation in this particular piece inside of the margin. So there's margins on the paper, and then there's the indentation. That indentation is important, and it's important because it indicates that this piece was printed. Okay, so it's a print. It's a very rare map. Now, maps are something that I always collected, and people say, you do? Yes. So if you're on a trip with me, and some of you have been on trips with me, you know that I get maps, and I usually get just an inexpensive map from somewhere, and I basically bring it home for my map collection. I'm gonna pick some up here and show you a couple of them. So this one is Helsinki, for example, when I was in Helsinki. This one's New York. I like an old tourist map of places like New York. And then also places like Graceland or Mount Rushmore or any type of place where I might have had an opportunity to go. But what maps are really coming in vogue now are maps like these. You know, this one, which would be a map where if you had to drive somewhere before GPS. Right? You remember before you had the actual phone telling you, turn right, turn left. We call her Susie in my car, you know. It's turn left, turn right. But maps are really nice and collectible. This particular map is pretty rare. First of all, I want you to look at the paper, and I want you to look if there's any browning or acid tanning. That's from, of course, the acidity let out of the paper. Also, I want you to look for striations in the paper. So if you're trying to figure out what's the most valuable, look for striations or handmade paper from, of course, wood pulp. You can see kind of little bits in it. You can see those kinds of things. If you see these little bits and if you see those striations, kind of like little tiny, very, very thin stripes, you probably see a older piece of paper. When it comes to maps, it's all about printing and it's all about process and it's all about paper. So I want you to think about those things. Printing, process, paper. And that's what you're going to do when you identify a valuable map. This particular map is worth $8,000. It's very rare. This piece is kind of cool, and it is a baby teething ring. Now, you all know I didn't have kids. I have no husbands. I have no hobbies. I have no kids. I don't do anything other than this, which is good. I like it. But basically, this particular piece is a baby teething ring. Now, you can see the ring, which looks like it's ivory. Well, it's not ivory. But certain naturally producing elements like ivory, like coral, were actually put into teething rings because it was thought that they had medicinal properties. Coral is the most famous. It was thought in the colonial times in the 19th century and the early 20th century that if a baby was sick, if they sucked on a teething ring of coral, it might make them better. And that was something in the 19th century that was pretty common. Ivory was seen as being related to nature, of course, like elephant ivory and such. And in fact, that particular type of ivory was also replicated and made into different types of reproduced materials, like composite materials like this. So that ring is not real ivory. It's actually a 1950s teething ring, and it's not real ivory, but it's a composite material that looks like ivory. What is real is the sterling silver duck charm. And that little charm is sterling silver and marked as such. So many of you, if you're trying to guess what's the most valuable, you're thinking, okay. Now, I didn't have a pacifier. I didn't have a teething ring. I was the youngest of three. You probably know this, and maybe I've said this before. And I was really big on my thumb. I liked my left thumb. I liked it a lot. So if I was sucking anything, I was sucking my left thumb as a kid, and not my right thumb. I had a particular thumb I liked, and I did, in fact, I'll confess, I sucked my thumb a long time, much longer than I should have as a little kid. And it was hard for them to stop it. I remember my parents going crazy. They would have to try to get, they would put anything on it. They would put a little bit of paprika on it. They would put, you know, types of spices I didn't really like cumin on it. To this day, I don't like cumin. I mean, all different things on my thumb to try to get me not to do it. And I had a dentist, actually. I had a dentist, and I would go to the dentist, and he would give me rings because they knew that I liked jewelry. I liked shiny things, even as a little kid. And you probably have kids and grandkids who like dress up and jewelry and stuff. So they would give me a fake ring at the dentist for every week on the calendar that I wouldn't suck my thumb. And it was a whole thing about my thumb growing up. Anyway, that I digress. So, but this particular teething ring, we didn't have baby teething rings in my house, but in fact, this particular baby teething ring with the sterling silver duck, which kind of, I think the shininess of the duck I might have been interested in as a little kid, but this particular baby teething ring was worth $75. Where's the value? In the sterling. And then there's this piece. This piece is a piece of Royal Haeger. You probably all recognize Royal Haeger. It has a nice teal color. And when you look at color, when you're trying to identify objects, I want you to look at the colors. I want you to think about bright colors. You know, bright colors mean prosperity. And bright colors in ceramics, in design of appliances of a particular time period, in kitchen Anna, relate to prosperity. So the brighter the color, the more prosperous the society at that time. That should tell you, boom, okay, this has to be after World War II. The 1950s, the 1960s, America's doing great in terms of course, manufacturing and prosperity and the economy. So this particular piece is a nice bright teal color, and it is a, you know, horn of plenty vase. Now, I'm not big on frou-frou. I kind of like it. Here's what it is. Here's how it is. So I don't have a lot of sort of flowers everywhere and such. I think it's a little bit too fussy for me, but that's just my taste. I do like the fact that it has a nice curve. I think all of those little elements are a little too much, but Royal Haeger was very well known as being the manufacturer of ceramics for florists. So in the 1950s and 60s, if you got a lovely, you know, arrangement from somebody, from a florist, oftentimes you'd have a Royal Haeger piece that went with it. You know, today they give you like a basket and not too much, you're trying to cut costs. But then they really gave you a nice piece of ceramic so you would have a piece to go with it. Usually there are two of these, so there's a set of two. And they go on either side of the mantle, right? Or they can go together. And in the 1960s, it was big to have these kinds of things to decorate, you know, the living room or where you watch TV or the mantle over the fireplace. This particular piece is, of course, ceramic and it's glazed, made in America. Value on it, $40. Did you pick the most valuable? I hope you're learning from these diverse object videos, and I hope you're choosing the most valuable. I'm Dr. Lori, the PhD antiques appraiser. Thanks again for watching.